Everyone, thank you so much for checking in this evening to this evening session of the Entrepreneur Bootcamp series. Tonight, we are going to be focusing on mental health and small business, and specifically pausing and avoiding burnout. I don't know how many of you have experienced or consistently experienced burnout. I know I do. And I think that we're in for a treat this evening. We've got a very dynamic speaker who is engaging and excited to be in front of all of you all. And her name is Ms. Cynthia Ciadot. But before we jump into tonight's program, I want to know, have any of you attended 9 or more Entrepreneur Bootcamp Series webinars? Because I believe we've only got 4 more left after this evening. Is that right? Yeah, this is the 5th from the last. And so if you want to take just a minute to type in your chat box and let us know if any of you have already attended 9 or more. I want you to know that you are already eligible for fabulous certification that's going to happen at our last boot camp event. All right. I am your formidable host this evening. Somebody wanted to, with gracious enough to give me tonight's hosting duties. My name is Lina Sepe, and yes, I am an estate planning attorney, but more importantly, I'm a very, very proud member of this illustrious chamber. And I just wanted to welcome you again to tonight's Entrepreneur Bootcamp Series webinar. Next slide, please. And first and foremost, a message from our fearless leader, President Lois Clipper.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Attorney Lioness. Welcome, everyone. I am, this is a much needed workshop for me. I am so looking forward to this. I think, you know, since the pandemic, it has given a different kind of importance to this topic. So we have been continuing these types of conversations because it's not all about business, but also first and foremost, taking care about ourselves so we can take care of business. So for those who are first time attendees here, we'd like to share a little bit about our chamber. So we have been established 21 years ago with about 115 members, and we are very active. We are the most vibrant chamber here in Southern California with about 2 to 3 events per month. So you're in the right spot. And we have strategic partners such as nonprofits, providing access to capital, workshops such as these, advocacies, local and Philippine government offices, partnerships, other chambers of commerce, media, and more. So what is the mission of our chamber? Oh, real quick. It's to promote, cultivate, connect, and empower the Filipino-American community and its allies for business development in Greater LA. So emphasis on allies, meaning we welcome everyone, not just Filipino-Americans. Our vision is to be the leading catalyst for the prosperity of businesses that share the values of the Filipino-American community. And we value these core values. It's excellence, innovation, entrepreneurial spirit, diversity, community outreach, integrity, sustainability, education, accessibility, and collaboration. Next. So we were not able to do this if it wasn't for our partnership with National ACE, which is the National Asian Pacific Islander American Chamber of Commerce and Entrepreneurship. The mission of National ACE is to advance Asian American and Pacific Islander business owners, providing one voice for the Asian American Pacific Islander business community, building capacity and fostering economic development through advocacy partnerships and programs. Next. So here's a little bit more about National ACE. I won't read through this, but this is again in partnership with them. Next. So as Attorney Lioness mentioned, this is the 10th out of the 14. So we are very excited. We're getting close to our graduation. So we need 9 out of the 14. But of course, you know, each webinar is so amazing. I've attended every single one of them, almost. Except one, I had to skip one because I was on a trip. But then it's so helpful for business owners to have this. And it's 14 sessions you can make up. There's recordings for that if you want to get a certificate. Next. Okay, back to you, Attorney Lioness.
Perfect. All right. So I have the absolute honor of introducing to you folks tonight's speaker. Cynthia Sidot is a proud queer second generation PhilAm licensed clinical social worker. She acknowledges and is grateful that she is inhabiting, living, and working on Tongva land. Committed to normalizing and destigmatizing mental health conversation, Cynthia received her graduate training at Columbia University School of Social Work and has been in the mental health field for over 15 years. She works with individuals and shares tools and resources typically reserved for the therapy room through her speaking, writing, and organization consultation around mental health. She is currently working on bringing Kapwa healing conversations to share the unique Filipinx gift of shared inner self to help create connection that can heal. And ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, tonight's speaker, Ms. Cynthia Sidot.
Hey, I can be my own audience. It's like that clap now kind of moment. Well, thank you so much, Lioness, for introducing me. And everybody, thank you so much for being here. You really, I love doing these workshops because of folks like you who will take a 6:30 p.m. on a Tuesday evening and just, you know, be here to hear something that potentially will help you take care a little bit more. So I am here for all of that. So if I could have my first slide. Aha. Okay, so this is the workshop that you're at in case there was any kind of question. Next slide, please. So we're working on pausing and avoiding burnout. And I'm noticing some folks like coming in, coming out. That's totally fine. I am happy to have whoever is able to be here for as long as they're able to be here. And so I'll just do a quick overview of what I'm going to be talking about tonight. So I'm going to introduce myself a little bit more, who I am, why I'm talking to you about this. I'll talk a little bit about, you know, the importance to me of doing this at this time, especially on October 18th, where, you know, over 400 years ago, I don't even know the number of years. But we, as Filipinos, first came to the United States via Morro Bay. So today, I am really excited to be doing this presentation to you. I'll be sharing a bit about why I consider myself a case study in burnout, just to normalize it a bit more. We'll talk about what is burnout, which I will be asking for your feedback and understanding of what burnout is, because certainly folks are no stranger to it. So I'll love your chatting participation then. So we'll talk about the signs and stress of burnout. And of course, the most important part of tonight will be talking about the tools to prevent burnout and also cope with burnout when it's happening. So this slide is just my reminder to let all of you know, when it comes to adult learning, we learn best when we're challenged just enough, but not challenged like upset, like triggered or like overwhelmed. So if at any point you feel overwhelmed or, you know, you start to feel a little disengaged or something, you know, take a break, you know, stand up, get a drink of water and return when you're ready. And, you know, like I said, coming in and out of this session is totally fine with me. I just welcome you back, even if I don't say it. So I'll welcome you back in my spirit. Because in this conversation, I will also be mentioning things like suicidal ideation, hospitalizations, and trauma, just as trigger warnings to come up. So, and thank you so much for being on top of my slides. Okay, so a little bit more about who I am. So again, Cynthia Ciadat, I'm proud, I'm queer, I'm Filipina American, I'm second generation, very proud of my parents who have given me lots of opportunities to become the person that I am. I'm a Columbia University grad. I have my private practice here in Los Angeles. I'm based in Los Angeles, but I work with people all over California. And I also do social emotional consultant work for groups and organizations like the Chamber of Commerce here. And I focus my work with high achieving caregivers. So if that doesn't immediately feel like that's you, I want to invite you to consider that as a small business owner, you are taking care of the people that you serve. And the high achieving part of it probably has something to do with the quality of work that you're trying to provide, what kind of value you're trying to provide. So I just want to expand that definition a little bit. And then just, you know, I mentioned I'm a mom to a now 10-month-old little boy. His name is Isa. And mentioned my parents. I also, with my parents, they have a number of health issues. So I also have, you know, on top of running my small business, which is my private practice, I also have the, you know, intermittent responsibility shared with me and my siblings for caring for my aging parents. So that's a little bit more about me. Next slide, please. So in honor of Filipino American Heritage Month, I want to acknowledge some of these statistics that came from the US Department of Health and Human Services. Their Office of Minorities actually published this information. So in 2018, they talked about how Asians as a whole were 60% less likely to have received mental health treatment compared to non-Hispanic white counterparts. Despite that, Southeast Asian refugees, and this includes folks who in the era of political disarray in the Philippines were displaced or had to move or felt threatened, had that kind of trauma related to prior to their immigration to the US. One study found that 70% of Southeast Asian refugees receiving mental health care were diagnosed with PTSD as a result. And so if there's a 60% less chance of there being treatment, but a 70% chance of PTSD being present, that tells us a lot about, you know, access and how important this information may be and all the different ways that we may want to be distributing. Next slide, please. And just to further put a finer point on this, unfortunately in 2019, they found that suicide was the leading cause of death for Asian American and Pacific Islanders ages 15 to 24. Asian American males who were in, you know, younger grades, like as young as like ninth grade, going through 12, 30% were more likely to consider attempting dying by suicide as compared to their non-Hispanic white counterparts. So these are really striking bits of information that I felt like are just important for us to acknowledge. Next slide, please. And not to mention with all that has happened with our experience of COVID and the increase of hate crimes against Asian American, Pacific Islander communities in the US, there's increased evidence of having depression, anxiety, self-injury, the non-suicidal self-injury like cutting, binge drinking, suicidal ideation. And this was just in in a study done on university students. So they went a little bit older than the high school students. And the findings also suggest that the COVID-19 pandemic precipitated discrimination, which has been linked to mental health problems, calling for more preventative interventions like this to address our population. We are included in the AAPI population, especially given our low rates of utilization of treatment. Next slide, please. And so why? So I talked to you a little bit about who I am, why this is important, and why I specifically am talking to you about this. And Lioneth mentioned this, I'm so passionate about normalizing mental health conversation. I think that bringing it to a light can help, you know, increase visibility and coping and sense of connection for people who are struggling. And I mentioned, I feel like I'm a cautionary tale for burnout. So just briefly, my story goes, I consider myself, how I got to working with high achieving caregivers is because I considered myself that very much. I take a lot of pride in the work that I do. And I had gotten to a place, I went to my graduate school, got to a certain level of management level work in a community clinic that I was managing. Let's see, the program itself had 500 plus clients in it for some of Los Angeles's most in need populations. So we're talking older adults in experiencing homelessness, mental illness, and substance use disorders, along with a number of health issues. So I'm doing my work. I think that, you know, this is my dream job. And it really was. Like, up until that point, I have this dream. I was going to be a manager in a community mental health setting. And I was going to have a small practice, which I did. That's when I started Living Fully Therapy, my private practice. And I was just kind of doing everything to the nines. And I was doing everything. I was commuting from Koreatown to Culver City every day. And it's like, you know, a good couple hours in the car, not unfamiliar to those of us living in Los Angeles. And I was just so attached to this idea that I had come to my dream job. And so I really didn't expect it, but there was a traumatic incident that happened for me while I was at work. I actually had my own life threatened anonymously. And like anonymously via note. It was like, you know, I just could not for the life of me put two and two together, my dream job and a threat at me. So it was like it was a moment of like really having to reconcile and not be in denial of the fact of I am so scared. But nevertheless, I was this high achieving caregiver. So I tried to push through it, keep showing up to work to where the point came. I was coming into my office and I would be the first person to come in and the last person to leave. And mostly I left security officer because I wanted to make sure I was safe leaving the building. Now, this does not sound like my dream job anymore. This sounds like the kind of job that leaves me feeling trapped. And I, you know, this is a very extreme example, I think, of how when we get to our dream job or our dream place, how much this idea of it being our dream job can be almost holding us hostage. So I got so scared. I got so scared of this person harming me. I went into my own depressive experience. And for anybody who's experienced a depressive episode, you know that your logic isn't always so sound, you know? It's like my logic went, I went to the hospital because I was scared I couldn't keep myself safe. So my logic was, if I die, if I cause myself to die, they won't hurt me. But the logic in that was really off, and I knew it was off. So I was like, this is really odd. And, you know, I went to get my own help, my treatment, all of those things. And the realization that I had come to was there was no amount of money at that point in time, nor ever again, that could have given me my mental health back. So, you know, this is really, I say I'm a poster child for this. I say I'm a cautionary tale because I very much feel like I am. And I very much feel like if I didn't have the tools that I have, I feel like I don't know where, how I would have turned out. So it's really important to me to share this information and these tools. So next slide, please. And I mean, this is probably obvious. Now I get to speak with folks like you on a regular basis. So this is really awesome for me. And thank you so much for being here. So before I hop into my next slide, I just want to extend, I know I've done quite a bit of talk in here, just to set the groundwork of who I am, why this is important, why I'm talking. And the thing that I want to say again, reiterate, is if you do need to take care of yourself, please do, you know, going on camera, going off camera, that is all good with me. You certainly did not have to come tonight, and yet you are here for you to get information. So my invitation to you is, yes, take care of yourself, take the breaks you need. But as we're talking tonight, as we're meeting, to really look for something for you, look for the gold nugget that you didn't have to come tonight to get, but you came and you got it and you are better off for it. That is my invitation to you tonight. So thank you so much. So good with my slides. I love this. So if you all would be so kind, I know that, you know, I said this before, I think majority of folks came on, but if you'd like to be on camera, you can be. If you don't want to be, that's okay. And the other way of participating that I love to use is chat. So this next section, I do want to ask the question before I flip to my next slide. I'd like to hear from a few people, either via chat, you can type it into the chat box, or you can unmute and just, you know, let me know like, hey, I have a thought. But what I want you to answer is, what are some signs of stress and burnout that you are already aware of? So now I'll give you a few moments here, but just type it into the chat, unmute, and I will open up my chat box so I can see responses. I'm just seeing these welcomes. Thank you so much. Yeah. So Lioness shared, I get short-tempered and impatient with my loved ones. Lois, yep. Lois, we'll be talking about this. The higher beats per minute, your heart rate goes up. Some people even talk about like temperature going up too when they're getting stressed out. I know that, these are great. You guys keep them coming. So when I would get stressed out before, I would feel like a burning sensation in my throat. Gemma says weight gain up and down. That's absolutely right. Yep. Sleepless night and days. Oh, those are terrible. Sleep is so, so important for us to cope with life in general. Without sleep, it makes it exponentially difficult. Anybody else want to chat or unmute? Either one is fine. Oh, I see you, Nico. Nice to see you again. All right. So then, you know, oh yes, Elaine, overwhelm makes concentrating very, very difficult. So these are great. Thank you so much. And if you have other notes or examples that you want to share that you don't see on, if I could have my next slide, please. So you'll recognize some of these same ones from our chat, but I'll just go down the list of them. So signs, some signs of stress and burnout, depression or anxiety, anger, irritability, like Lioness mentioned, it's like irritability with the people closest to us, who oftentimes have no inkling that we're having this time, you know, that's really difficult. Someone also mentioned, Lillian mentioned the overwhelm or feeling unmotivated to focus, you know, like that's really hard. Racing thoughts, constant worry, sleeping little too little or too much, or having trouble with sleep, like, and by trouble with sleep, it's like hard to fall asleep, hard to stay asleep, hard to get restful sleep, interrupted sleep, all kinds of things can happen with that. Problems with memory or concentration, making mistakes on everyday actions like losing our keys, forgetting lunch, or forgetting to eat, period, not even just lunch. You know, I spoke with one of my clients today and it was around, 2 o'clock. And she let me know that she had only had cereal, but at 6 a.m. And so I was like, okay, so we're gonna have you eat while we're meeting. because, you know, it's just that hour of time to take care. Isolating oneself. And then I love that, Lois, you talked about the physical symptoms. So like the higher beats per minute, but sometimes chest pain, unexplained headache, anxiety, and the gut or bowel problems are becoming in more clearly and clearly tied. Stinging or burning sensations around the body. I've worked with people who had like tingling sensations or burning sensations in their hands and legs. Difficulty relaxing certain muscle groups, low libido, and frequent colds or infections or just illness, exacerbated illness. And then lastly, being overly critical of oneself or others. Lois gave a real example. I look at my Fitbit and it shows. absolutely. I used to wear my Apple Watch and I would see my, like I'd be resting and I'd be like, holy, like trying to take a deep breath. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, so let me see here. Okay, and then I do want to expand a little bit more on that. Thanks, Lois. Next slide, please. Of how stress and burnout can affect our physical health. So stress has been linked to chronic diseases. So we're talking about like diabetes, asthma, cancer, cardiovascular disease, arthritis flare-ups. Mental health effects can also make dealing with chronic illnesses so much more difficult. I wrote here that about the mortality rate among people with depression or other mental health conditions that are living with like a heart disease or a cancer, they have a 5-time more likelihood of mortality than folks who aren't dealing with those things. People with mental health conditions can develop sleep disorders like sleep apnea and insomnia. People with mental health conditions are more likely to smoke than those who don't have mental health conditions. Not all, but it's more likely. And people with depression have the reason for this is that people with depression have lower levels of the chemical dopamine, and the nicotine in cigarettes actually trigger the production of dopamine. So meaning that smoking can be a way to relieve symptoms of depression at times. And then lastly, access to healthy care and the ability to manage our physical symptoms can be made more challenging by mental health conditions. Like think of somebody going through a depressive episode, they may lose motivation to seek care, take their medications as prescribed, or to exercise regularly. It's like they know all the things that they want or need to do, but the mental health component of it is ultimately the barrier to having them do the thing that they need to do. So next slide, please. So what makes burnout so difficult to deal with? Next slide. So we have this internalized understanding that self-care is selfish. While we're inside of a society that historically favored production over human well-being. And we all know that term, secure your oxygen mask first, and yet many of us feel that it is still even then selfish and difficult or just impossible to occasionally prioritize our own well-being. And societally, it's just been encouraged in generations before that we work ourselves to the bone. And, you know, the model, we lacked models for self-care. And these are just more reasons why it's so difficult. But we didn't have models for self-care. This is relatively new. You know, like I have been in the mental health field for 15 years. And still, some of this information is new. And I'm like, what? How did we not know that before? But we really just didn't have it. Even 15 years ago. and then lastly, if anyone's ever heard somebody, you know, coming back from a trip, like if you've been in other work environments where, you know, you come back from a trip or somebody comes back from a trip and they're talking about how great their trip was, and there's just kind of like a reaction of like, well, that must be nice. Like, that was nice for you. Or sarcastic, so happy for you. You know, it's like that kind of social dynamic does exist in the workplace at times. And it can be a sort of like, if we veer out of the line of productivity, someone will almost immediately, swiftly and promptly check us back and say, get back in line, get back in line, be productive. So, I say all of this information, and this is the most important part. So next slide. What can we do about it? So in my next slide, I have a number of very simple pink slides. They just say like a phrase or a word on them. And some of them will have kind of exercises that are part of them. So, you know, that's what you'll see. Feel free to participate in them. I've tried to mix them up a bit, but know that I issued a handout with a few of these techniques on them as well. So, you know, if you have questions about that, you can reach out to Lioness or Fidji or really anybody who's hosting here tonight to have access to that handout. So, I would like my next slide. All right. Yes, no, that was perfect. That was perfect timing itself. So the first of which is to move your body. So I have an exercise for this. I do want to provide, I'm a bit of a neuropsych nerd, so please humor me. But one of the books that I have come across in my years of studying was this book called Ending the Cycle of Stress Burnout. It was by a couple of women who are sisters, Nagowski, I believe is their last name. I typed that into the chat. Nagowski. And they talk a bit in really accessible and really plain everyday language, talking about some of the more intensely complicated concepts that I think just get overly jargony in other books. So I really love their book. But they talk about the importance of moving our bodies, especially when we are experiencing or moving towards burnout. The reason for this is, you know, when we are experiencing burnout or busyness or stress or overwhelm, there is a part of our brain that many of you are probably familiar with, the fight, flight, or freeze process. There's the sympathetic nervous system part of your brain that is going off and basically taking all of the energy from your entire brain and having you panic. So it's pulling a finite resource of the energy that's in your mind, pulling it from your creative centers, from your executive functioning centers, decision-making centers, and pulling it back to the freak-out centers, essentially. So moving your body has been shown to help release the grip that the sympathetic nervous system can have when we're busy, again, busy, overwhelmed, stressed, burned out, and bringing it back to these other parts of our brains and our functioning. So, you know, any kinds of moving your body work, you know, or can work, walking, dancing, any kind of movement, your favorite kind. But the one that I want to share with you tonight is one that you could do sitting in a chair, or usually I'm standing, but tonight I'm not standing. So I won't do the standing version of this exercise. I'll do the sitting version. But it's called the wave. So if you are sitting in your chair, this is my beginning of an invitation for you to practice this. And if you're on the camera, I will let you know, you do move quite a bit for this. So if you do want to not be on the camera, you can do that too. But I'm going to be on the camera just so you know what it can look like, and that it is actually kind of silly, but it's, I promise, can be really wonderful. So if you're sitting in a chair, sit nice and comfortable. So find your sit bones. You might need to like shift side to side a little bit. And if your feet are on the floor, oh my God, my feet are not on the floor. I'm short, really short. If your feet are on the floor, feel the floor beneath your feet and just gently press your feet right and left into the ground. And then let that movement travel up through your ankles, your calves. So already you see my upper body moving a little bit. Your knees, have that right, left wave movement go back and forth through right hip, left hip, low back. And then your rib cage, shoulders and upper back. It's almost like a dance move already. Your jaw, your neck. And your ears, your forehead, and top of your head. I'm going to try to do this while I'm waving. But we're going to continue to do this together for 1 minute, and I'll start the clock now. And just let the wave be as flowing as you can. So it's like you can go as fast as you want. You could go as slow as you want. Whatever feels right for your body tonight, because this may be different on another day. But just what it is for right now. I love some brave souls. Yeah. We do this in dance class. Yes. Yeah. It's so good for us. We've got about 30 seconds more, you guys. I can hear my crack too. I don't know if you can hear. My microphone is right next to my neck and it went. Good. All right. Keep it going. 10 more seconds. And really, if you feel, yeah, it really does feel good. If you feel any particular area that's like wanting you to move it, go ahead and move it.
Hello, yeah. Miss Hope. Where did you come from?
Oh, hello.
Yeah.
Oh. I hear an echo. Okay. And if you've been waving, go ahead and come to stillness. And as you come to stillness, I want you to keep the sensation of movement contained inside your still body for 15 seconds. taking some nice slow breaths. So if you did that exercise, if you were trying that at home, if you want to type into the chat, what was that like for you to do? What did you notice? I already got some folks here saying they heard the cracks and it felt pretty good. You know, Lois, I was thinking in the dance class, there is a type of dance that's called gaga, and it really is just like people moving like all kinds of ways. So we notice cracks and pops, notice how tight my neck and shoulder were. Yep, it was fun. Oh, I'm so glad, Celeste. Good to do daily at work every so often. Yeah, it's like every so often we want to get up. Somewhere it's like once an hour, I think is the recommended amount. Reminded me how old I am. I hear you. I mean, like, these cheeks, don't let them fool you. But yeah, I get it. It's like it hurts. Everything hurts. I woke up the other day and like couldn't move my neck. I was like, it's just like this. Okay, good. Yeah, and if you're in the process of typing a response, please continue. I do want to read it. I'm going to move to my next slide. It's not an activity, but more so just more something we've talked about. So getting enough sleep. So I'm going to talk about my best tool that I've found so far that for us to get the best kind of sleep. And it's a simple checklist of things. So, so the order that it comes in, and I'm gonna, as I go, I'm gonna have them typed into the chat. But the first thing to do in the evening, when we are trying to go to sleep, one of the things that we really want to try and develop is a night routine that can help us unwind and relax and feel like, okay, what's done for today is done. What's coming tomorrow is coming tomorrow. Right now is sleep. So here are four items that I've practiced myself. I've suggested to my clients, and they found helpful. So they may be helpful for you, but I encourage you to kind of play around and see what works for you. But the first thing that was recommended was to check your to-do list or calendar for the following day and just kind of know and envision what's happening for the next day. Don't like do the work of it, but just know what's coming for the next day. The next recommendation was to set a time where screens turn off. And some of us, I mean, like I'm not so handy with my phone, but I know that there are some features on the phone that will say like your bedtime is happening in an hour or your, you know, it, especially with, I know iPhones will have that feature. Use your tools that are available to you to set a time when all screens turn off. That's your phone, your computer, TV, projectors. Somebody asked me, does my projector count? Yes, your projector counts. And so just video game consoles, all of that. Selecting a time when those turn off and using that for the next piece as a green light to do a relaxing activity. And that could be any relaxing activity of your choice, whether that's reading or stretching, taking a bath or taking a shower or meditation. These are just some examples. I know other folks, you know, they draw, they sing, they play music, they just do some relaxing activity. They spend time with their pets. And then lastly, simplest of all, go to your bed. That is the last must have that has been recommended in different, I'm pulling these from different bits of research and readings that I've done over the years. And these are the consistent things that I find help put people's minds at ease a little bit quicker, and then also help them recognize and develop a routine. How do you quiet the mind once your head hits the pillow? I have a recommendation for this that folks keep either don't keep. I don't like to have folks' phones next to their bed. I think that that's too tempting. But if you can have like a little piece of paper or notepad, when you have something, or some folks journal, that's another activity that could be a relaxing activity. When you have your mind, there are two things that I there are two things that I recommend for folks. One is, if you're a journal person, have a journal next to your bed, and whatever's kind of like eking in your mind, write it down instead of thinking about it, and put it in bullet points versus like narrative form. It's like, if you're thinking about, I'm thinking about my son, thinking about work, thinking about my neighbor who did this thing, you know, it's like there, it's very short, but it's almost like you're creating a to-do list for your thoughts, but for tomorrow you, if you so choose. But probably when you wake up in the morning, you're not gonna wanna think about those things. It's just there to put your mind at ease that it is not going unnoticed. So that's one thing, if you are the type of person to journal. The other thing that I found really helpful when my mind is really busy is to do, you could YouTube this, but because there are so many different kinds of activities for it, but it's something called progressive muscle relaxation. And it's basically going, you know how we did the wave and it went from our feet to the top of our head? You're basically doing the same thing, but in your sleep or while you're laying there, you kind of squeeze and contract each section. So it's like squeeze your feet for 10 seconds, and let it go, sink into your bed. Squeeze your calves and your quads and all your legs, squeeze those and relax. And keep doing that until you get to the top of your head, and see if that helps bring the focus away from up here into your body again. Our bodies are really, really helpful to us in terms of managing what tends to go so haywire up here. So that's one recommendation. All right, good. Yeah, if there are questions as we're going, please do type them in. Okay, so, I forgot my own slide that was next. We have a progressive muscle relaxation technique that I'm gonna teach you. So this is one. And Fiji, I know that you have your child with you. So Ken, if you want to participate, you can. I don't know, it might be late, sure. Because this is actually an activity that I do with adults, teenagers, young kids. When my baby can understand it, I will have him do it. But it is something called, and it's kind of silly, called uncooked and cooked noodle. So you know how with, you know, uncooked spaghetti noodles, they're like really straight, really rigid, really hard. So when I say uncooked noodle, what I'm going to ask for you to do, and again, if you have your camera on, you're one of my brave ones, but if you don't want to have your camera on, totally fine. But I will have mine on. So what you're going to do is, I'm going to say uncooked noodle, and you're going to like cinch everything up from head down to your toes. And I'm gonna demonstrate it just like this. And we're gonna hold it together for 10 seconds. And then when I say cooked noodle, you're gonna let it all go and like let it fall. It's really fun with kids, especially if you have them do cooked noodle and then like drape over you. It's very good, very fun for them. I did it with my niece and my nephew and they were like, yes. Okay, so then ready. We're gonna try this, so I'm gonna say, here we go. uncooked noodle. So cinch everything up, tighten hands into fists, even you know, down to your toes for 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and cooked noodle. Okay, we're going to do that two more times together. All right, so you're ready and uncooked noodle. Okay, and even your face too, get your face in it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and cooked noodle. Good. All right, one more. Ready? And uncooked noodle. And this time everything, elbows in, tummy, hips, knees, face. And 5, 4, 3, 2, and cooked noodle. And let it go. Okay. So Celeste, you act and you shall receive. I want to hear from folks, either unmuted or chat. What did you notice? Yes, it's very different, pretty silly, awesome. Thank you for doing it with me. Yeah, I'd love to hear how people reacted, how it felt. What are they feeling now? Oh, good. Yeah, do. And, you know, keep me posted. Please let me know if they enjoy it, if they find it silly. Chances are they'll find it silly. It's like, well. Yeah, definitely much looser than when we started. Yep. Your body feels more relaxed. That makes me so happy to hear. Great. And if you're in the process of typing, please continue to do so. I'm going to move, if I could have my next slide. So talking about another tool that you could use is seeking the help and company of others. And I would have made a quick edit in there of saying company of safe others, not just anybody, but people who you feel safe with. And the reason for this is, again, in that book about from the Nagowski sisters, they reference this and talk about it in at length, and it's really great. Thinking evolutionarily, when we used to like run from animal predators and like live in tribal communal spaces, once we reached our villages and our people who we knew we were safe with, our minds knew that we were in safe company. And not to mention, say, for example, that same community gathers around a fire, has dinner, relaxes, talks about the day. There is a part of our brain that can go off and just tell us, now's not the time to be running. Now is the time to be relaxed and connected. And just by speaking openly about ourselves with others who we deem safe. And again, there, and how I gauge when somebody is safe for us is, how does your body feel? Does your body feel relaxed when you're with them? If it does feel relaxed, the chances are they're pretty safe for you. And when we deem them safe and we share with them, we can actually activate a part of our nervous system called the ventral vagal system. And it's really tied right here around our heart. And that's the part of our nervous system that's responsible for helping us relax and feel at ease. And that's just by telling somebody about our day. So seeking the help and company of others is the next one. And next slide is my last slide for recommendations, because I don't want to over inundate, but getting creative. So I mentioned before that there's like this part of our brain that like really get busy running part of our brain, the sympathetic nervous system. One of the other ways, so we talked about moving, being with people, doing muscle relaxation, those kinds of things, can help bring all of that functioning back to our creative executive functioning, which is our parasympathetic. So sympathetic, parasympathetic. Getting creative is another way to access this part of our brain, which is vital for us as small business owners. So this could look like engaging in any kind of creative activity, arts, whether you enjoy listening to music, doing crafts, tinkering. Like I know some people really like, you know, taking things apart and putting them back together, like that kind of stuff, or puzzles, or even just doodling, like simply taking a pen. Yes, Lois, dancing. Thank you. And that's like multiple things. That's like music and movement and social, if it's a social kind of, like, wonderful. I love dancing as an activity. But that, you know, all of these creative outlets can activate this part of your brain that will, it's referred to, but related to this part of the brain, the parasympathetic part, the creative decision-making, executive functioning part, but it's called the default mode network. And it's like what that part of our brain that goes into unfocus. And it basically just gives the brain a break. And we need both. We need both our focused mind and our unfocused mind. And we couldn't focus without the unfocused. So we need to be able to allow our brains to get to catch a break. I took this bit of information from Dr. Srini Pillai over at UCLA. He's a neuropsychologist. His name in the chat. And he wrote a book called Tinker, Dabble, Doodle, Try. Wonderful book. Talks about his research of why being creative and tinkering and dabbling in stuff is so good for us and for our brains. So these, he found that both of those things, focus and unfocus, are needed for us to optimally function. So with that, I'm going to open up the floor. That's the last of my recommendations for any questions. I know I only have a couple of minutes here. I do want to acknowledge the time. It's 7:28. But if you have any questions, please feel free to type them in the chat or unmute. Oh, I love seeing faces. Cool. Okay. And the last slide just had my my contact information, but I will actually, can I?
Yeah, Cynthia, can you actually put your information again in the chat box for all of us?
Yeah, Perfect. Absolutely. Let me do that. And so that is me. So that was my presentation. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, please feel free to take my contact information and I'm happy to be a resource. So thank you.
All right. Thank you, Cynthia. So, you know, I know she encouraged each and every one of us to find that golden nugget here tonight's talk. And I personally, myself, probably found like 4 or 5 of them. So there you go with the Jedi mind trick again, Cynthia. I know that, you know, as entrepreneurs, business professionals, we are, you know, we've always got our heads in the rat race, right? How much more productive can we be? How many clients can we close? How much money at the end of the day can we pull in? And we really don't take a lot of time to sort of pause and take our own temperatures. And I hope that tonight, Cynthia, you know, gave you that reminder that we're only human, right? We do burn out. We do stress out. If that's not you, you're lying. No, I'm just kidding. you know, but, you know, and of course, she did acknowledge that there's a lot of taboo and stigma still with regard to mental health, especially within our community. And I know that I feel like this is like the time for talks to, you know, be more at the forefront and really for ourselves to really pay attention, right, to ourselves and to others, and definitely be more sympathetic. So she, Cynthia, left her information for all of us, and it was also on the slide. I encourage you to use her as a resource because she clearly knows a lot. I mean, she had us all wiggling in our chairs, you guys. What?
And thank you again. If you wiggled in your chair, even with your camera off, it's like,
yes. Don't tell me that didn't help you a little bit this evening. Don't tell me that. Because I know.
Yes.
So that was everything wonderful. Thank you so much, Cynthia. I know a few of us, a bunch of us, a whole lot of us are going to reach out to you.
Yes, please do.
Yes. All right, and we are going to move on with our program. Can I get that next slide up, please? Oh, I think now is the time that we are going to all take our group photo. So for those of you who are brave enough, go ahead and turn on those cameras and show us all your pearly whites. Who's taking the picture? Lois?
Yeah, I can.
Okay, here we go.
Okay. 1, 2, 3. Beautiful.
Hey! Thank you, Lois. All right, thank you for those of you who dared to bear and grin your teeth. Go. All right, so next slide, please. Oh. Thank you to our logo sponsors. I'm from the Collins Law Group. for those of you who are not familiar, we do specialize in estate planning. And so if you've heard phrases like living trusts, power of attorneys, I'm your girl, I don't bite, don't hesitate to ask questions or just kind of get educated about the topic. Next slide, please. We also want to encourage you, if you are not already a member of FACCGLA, please know that individual memberships are $150, corporate memberships are $300. Tonight was just a little taste of what you tend to get at our virtual events. You can see that we are a very vibrant organization. We're very animated, and we like being friends with people. All right, next slide, please. We do have perks and benefits for our members. And so I encourage each and every one of you to check out this QR code. Go ahead and scan it. You will get access to the Chamber's ebook of perks and benefits. Next slide, please. All right, and on to our Vice President of Events, Mr. Miko Pulon.
Thanks, Attorney Lioness. So for our upcoming events, we have actually 4 events left for our webinar series. But first, our West Valley Food and Wine Oasis participation. We have our booth that's actually going to be tomorrow night at the Woodland Hills Jaguar/Land Rover location in Woodland Hills at Topanga Canyon Boulevard. So please check that out if you're around. Next is our Entrepreneur Bootcamp series continues for next week. That's going to be on the 25th. We have Supplier Diversity, featuring Miss Karen Blackwell as our guest speaker. And then the week after would be our government contracting with guest speaker Andrew Barrera. And then a Google speaker will be presenting on how to sell online with e-commerce tools. And then finally, our graduation. We have the Art and Science of Networking. That's going to be our rooftop graduation, and you'll get to meet your cohort and speakers. That's on November 16. Save the date, please. Thank you.
All right, guys. Well, your feedback matters. So what you can expect is that each and every one of you will be receiving an email from the Chamber. We do look forward to all of your input with regard to tonight's topic and really any comments and opinions that you may have, hopefully all positive, about the program that we put on here at the Chamber. Next slide, please. We've got your executive officers pictured here. And I just want to remind you that they work very hard to put on these fabulous events and to make sure that, you know, we've got a working and cohesive and dynamic team. Next slide, please. And of course, we've got your board members also pictured, and most of us are attending here tonight. Very proud members of the chamber. Next slide, please. All right, I've got another QR code for you. This is the Linktree QR code. If you scan that, it'll bring you to that page that you see on the left. So feel free, go ahead, take out your phones and check us out there. Next slide, please. And please stay in touch. There's our information for you there. You can also scan that QR code and save that contact. Again, if you are not already a member of this wonderful chamber, I invite you to check us out, join a few more virtual events, or even join in person. Next slide, please. And this is where I get to thank all of you again for the last time this evening. Thank you so, so much, Cynthia Cedot, for enlightening us, for making us move, helping us to feel less stressed. And any closing remarks that you want to leave all of us with?
Oh, really? Thank yourselves for being here. I hope you did get your gold nugget, and you can thank yourself for those for showing up tonight. So thank you for having me, and yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Cynthia, and all of you ladies and gentlemen who checked in this evening. We are so grateful. Please remember that if you have not already attained your 9 events to get that certification, there's still time. We have 4 more events until graduation, and I hope to see you all there. Take care, everybody, and I'll see you till the next event in this bootcamp series. And thanks again, Cynthia. Bye, everyone.
Bye.